Welcome back to my greenhouse. I'm Joe. Thank you for joining. Have you actually ever asked yourself or wondered what the names printed or written on the plant labels, name tags, or pot stickers of your cacti and other succulents actually mean? Or perhaps also where they come from? In this video, I'd actually like to give you a few simple infos and tips to help you understand and decipher these names and labels much easier when you're buying or looking around for new plants in nurseries. And also, which type of very useful information you can gain from better understanding the sometimes rather complicated and even somewhat intimidating looking names on the plant labels. Also, why is it actually pretty useful to know the name of the cactus or the succulent that you are buying? Well, it's important simply because if you're wanting to look up more information about a plant, where it originally comes from, how to best grow it, and so on, then without knowing the exact name of that plant, I think you'll find it quite difficult to find that information. So let's take a look at a few typical cactus plant labels or pot stickers. First of all, let's say then that you've just bought this cactus here in your favorite cactus nursery. Then high chances that your plant came with a sticker or a label that reads Echinocactus grusoni. On the other hand, if you just purchased your cactus in a supermarket or a popular garden center, the name shown on the label might now just read Golden Barrel Cactus. Now it turns out, in fact, that one, of course, the first one is the scientific or the botanical name, and the other one, the second, is the common name used for the very same cactus, Echinocactus grusoni, Golden Barrel Cactus. So two very different names used for the very same cactus. And you can, of course, in principle, choose to use either of the two names for your cactus. Or, by the way, just one from left field, you could choose to simply ignore both these names and just simply give your cactus a favorite nickname, you know, Spiky, Napoleon, whatever you choose. But let's stay with the two labels and the botanical versus the common names that we now have. You might be rightfully wondering right now, so what is the better name? Which one should I be using? And my answer is, it depends really, as it's not about the better or the right name, it's more about the information that you're looking to get from the name on the label. In principle, you can use either, of course, but let me now first explain why and what the main differences are between the scientific and the common names. That plant label from just now that showed Golden Barrel Cactus, in a different supermarket or plant center, that could also have read Golden Ball Cactus or Mother-in-Law's Cushion or Mother-in-Law's Seat or Mother-in-Law's Armchair or Mother-in-Law's Pillow and so on and so on. Not very flattering names, but these are all valid, so to speak, common names being used for the very same cactus. So it turns out that these are all quite widely used common names for that very same cactus. And that is where a potential problem starts with using common names. There can often be quite a few common names, different ones obviously, being used for the very same type of plant. In fact, the more popular a cactus or a succulent is, often the more names that you will find being used for it. Also, the common names used will often be quite different from country to country, region to region, language to language, and so on. Well, to make things even more confusing and difficult for us hobbyists, sometimes the very same common name will actually also be used for very different types of cacti or plants. Take, for example, the common cactus name, Queen of the Night. It's used in German, Dutch, and a couple of other languages, very confusingly, I must say, for two very different types of cactus plants. So, Queen of the Night is used for the long and thin-stemmed snaking Selenicereus grandiflorus, with its huge white or pink-colored flowers that show at night, hence the name. That same name is also used for several also white to pink flowering cacti, but quite different, unrelated globular cacti from the genus Echinopsis from Bolivia. They also have large flowers and bloom at night, hence also called Queen of the Night. Now, in several English-speaking countries, this same common name, Queen of the Night, is now used again for a totally different type of cactus, Epiphyllum oxypetalum, which is actually an epiphytic cactus, so one that lives on trees, grows on trees, a bit like orchids. And of course, it also has large white flowers, guess what, that show at night, hence Queen of the Night. Oh, and guess what, staying with English-speaking regions, here, that very same snaking Selenicereus grandiflorus, which we said was called Queen of the Night in Germany and the Netherlands, for example, it now holds about 10 different common names I could find in English, including large flowering cactus, lunar flower, vanilla cactus, sweet-scented cactus, Queen of the Night, night-blooming cereus, large-blooming cereus, large-flowered torch thistle, large-flowered night cactus, and so on, and so on. Well, have I got you totally confused by now? I suppose that's the point I'm trying to make about common names, really. And I think you definitely get the gist of my story so far. Common names are, of course, very descriptive, usually easier to pronounce, and mostly also much easier to remember. But of course, at the same time, they're not very precise, obviously not scientific, and they can sometimes introduce more confusion than clarity. So for example, if you're looking up a specific cactus or plant for more information on it in a book or on the web, or if you're looking for it to purchase in a nursery or online plant shop, in the worst case, you may well end up unwrapping quite a different plant at home to what you thought you had ordered. So this is, of course, where botanical or scientific names come in. They usually are words coming out of the Latin or the Greek languages, and they consist of two parts or words. The first, in our example, Echinocactus, that's the genus name. It's a bit like our surnames or family names. And the second is Gruzoni, that's the species name. So that's the species within the genus Echinocactus, a bit like our given names. By the way, the genus names are usually always capitalized, so the first letter will be a capital letter. The species names, on the other hand, are not capitalized. Now, you simply cannot talk about botanical plant names without briefly mentioning a few short fun facts about their origin, because it's quite interesting, really. This way of naming our cacti and most other living beings on our planet, whether plants or animals for that matter, so using a genus followed by a species name, we call that the binomial nomenclature. And it goes back to the amazing Swedish botanist and scientist Carl Linnaeus, or Carl von Linné, who was born over 300 years ago, way back in 1707. Carl Linnaeus is also known as the father of modern taxonomy. He introduced this so-called binomial nomenclature in 1753, I think, in order to finally bring an order and a system into the chaos of common plant and animal names that were the only ones being used until then. He was a true genius and one of the most acclaimed scientists in Europe by the time he died at the age of 70. Quite frequently asked question around cactus plant labels and name tags is, where actually do the genus and the species or subspecies names come from, and what do they mean? Now, these genus and species names are often quite descriptive Latin or Greek words. In our example, the echinocactus, echinus means hedgehog, so echinocactus is the genus of hedgehog-like cacti, which of course is a great reference to the super hard and prickly spines of these cacti, like the spines of a hedgehog. But often also geographical place names, as in Peruvianus, or flower colors, as in rubriflorus, or spine colors or forms, rubrispinus, plant shapes, as in columnaris, or even names of people are used in Latin or Greek. Again, staying with our example of the echinocactus gruzoni, this plant was described in 1891 and was named after a quite famous industrialist and cactus collector from Magdeburg in Germany, Hermann Gruson, hence Gruzoni. But let's get back now again to our cactus plants and their scientific names. What do you think? How many cacti are there within the plant family of the Cactaceae? A lot, many thousands. But luckily, thanks to Linnaeus, there's actually a system, there's a hierarchy that is there to help us understand the relationship between the different plants. So if we start at the higher level first, at the genus level, let's take a look at the cactus genuses, actually genera, first. In total, there's around 130 or so genera, and many of these you'll see and recognize on your plant labels. For example, Astrophytum, Copiapoa, Gymnocalycium, Echinocactus, Echinopsis, Opuntia, Mammillaria, Parodia, Rebutia, and so on. So that's the cactus genus. And then at the next level, below the genus, every cactus genus has at least one species, usually several or many species. So to stick with our example of the Echinocactus gruzoni, another closely related Echinocactus, so another species within that genera, would be, for example, Echinocactus platyacanthus. And as I briefly mentioned, some genera actually only have one species. Most cactus genera, though, have several, actually many species belonging to them. For example, the genus Opuntia, it has over 300 species alone. So, across the 130 or so cactus genera, there are anywhere between 1,700 and 2,000 different described and valid species of cacti. And amazingly, there are still several new species being discovered every year, especially from remote areas. Okay, so we've got the genus, we've got the species, so those two names, that's the typical pair of names that we will find on most plant labels. Right, folks, that's it for today, and that's it for part one of two parts that come to this video about better understanding your cactus and other succulent plant names, plant labels, and pot stickers. In part two, which I'll be posting next week, we'll be looking at why there are very often actually more than just two names to your cactus labels, so beyond the genus and the species name, why that is, what the most common abbreviations that are used actually mean, and the key terms like subspecies, variation, forms, cultivars, hybrids, what they all mean and how you can actually use them to better understand the background to your various cactus and other succulent plants. I hope you're finding this video and this information interesting and useful. It is probably a little bit of a dry topic, but as I stressed at the beginning of the video, it is really, really important for you to know what the actual name of your plants are and also how to better read the plant labels that come along with your plants. As I said, knowing the plant names will really help you understand how to better cultivate your plants, how to better grow them, get them to flower, and making sure that they're actually staying in good, healthy condition. If you are finding this video interesting and useful, then please do not forget to actually like and or comment on the video. And also, if you haven't already done so, please do subscribe to this channel. And when you're subscribing, please don't forget to actually hit the bell icon. That will ensure that you receive automatic notifications about all new uploaded videos on this channel. Thanks again for watching. Take care. Hopefully see you very soon again. Happy growing.